What's going on, guys? Austin here at The Vault. Today, I'm gonna be doing a video demonstrating the three main compressions out there for you guys to ride. Those compressions are SES, HIC, and IHC. Today, I'm gonna be demonstrating how it is you actually put them together, what you need, the pros, the cons, the good things, the bad things about the three compressions. Hopefully, we can figure out which one's best for you. The first compression that we are gonna be starting out with is SES. It's personally what I ride. This right here is actually my scooter. I really wanted to show you guys firsthand how to put it together on a used scooter because a lot of people think with newer scooters, it's the only way it works with brand new parts. So let's get into SES first. I'm gonna demonstrate how to put it together. So right here is everything that you're pretty much going to need. You're gonna need your headset, 1 and 2 bearings for the top and the bottom. You're gonna need your compression ring. This will come with any integrated headset. Your dust cover, this also will come with the headset. Depending on what fork you get, this is the compression screw that my fork has. I'm riding the Lifeboat Flamongo fork, so it's the big one that screws in. You may have one that looks like this. This sits in your SES and screws down into your fork, which I'll demonstrate in just a sec. And then last but not least, you're gonna need your SES. For mine, I'm running the Proto Z Martini Baby SES. And the last but not least is the headset spacer. You may or may not need one of these. This comes in handy when you have a very long fork. In my case, I just need a small one. This is a 10 mil, and I'll demonstrate when you'll need one. So let's get into building this thing. So you want to take your first headset bearing. You can turn the deck upside down and put it in. Personally, I just like sliding it right down the fork like so with the grooves facing up because that's how it goes into the deck. Taking your deck, sliding it, headset bearing goes in. If you feel like your headset bearing isn't going in, you can grab some lithium grease. You can get this at a local bike shop. Rub a little bit in your headset bearing. Take a rubber mat like I have here. Slowly tap it in evenly. You don't wanna just hammer this bearing in. You wanna go from one side to the other to make sure it goes in nice and evenly. Once you put your bottom bearing in like so, grab your top bearing with the grooves right here. You can see the grooves. Goes down to match the grooves in the deck. There's a lot of play in the fork, as you can see. That's when your compression ring. It's this thin ring with a slit in it. This comes with your headset. You slide this down, bam. That fills the gap between the fork and the bearing. Play's gone. Next, you get your dust cover. What this does is this blocks all the dirt and water and all that stuff you're riding through from getting into the actual bearing. Bam. So this is where a headset spacer comes into play. A lot of people don't know what it does. It's gonna fill the gap from your SES to your fork because if you didn't know, with SES compression, your fork only sits halfway in the clamp. You can see right in the SES, there's a lip. That's where your bars sit and your fork sits under that. When you drop in your compression screw, which I'll demonstrate right now, you have to have a decent sized gap for it to compress down into your fork. Let me slide this down. So you can see, if you look down, my fork is nice and flush with that lip. You don't want that. You have to have a lip and a gap so when I screw it down, it can compress down. So if I were to tighten my SES down right now, even though it's as tight as I can get it, it's gonna wobble. I'm gonna put my headset spacer on. It's gonna fill the gap and allow me to properly tighten my headset down. I'm using a 10 mil because it adds a little bit of height to my bar too, not much. We sell these guys for about $1.50, $2 per headset spacer, and they do come in variant sizes, so I recommend grabbing a couple different sizes. And if you do buy a Odyssey headset, Odyssey is a BMX company, and these come very handy when it comes to riding BMX, so they actually just throw in a couple with their headsets. So as you can see, I slide it down my fork, it sits nice and flush. Now I take my SES. Now there's a gap from that lip in my SES to my actual fork. So when I drop this guy in and it tightens down, it's gonna compress it, making it so I can tighten my headset properly. So I'll do that now. So I drop that in. This is a big screw, so take the lip to screw in. So I hit it right there, it's good. Right now what I'm doing is I'm aligning my SES with my wheel to make sure it's nice and straight. Grabbing the wheel and just finishing the tightening process. You don't wanna go too much, you just wanna feel that resistance, maybe loosen just a tad bit, and bam. You basically wanna get half spin every time. That's what I consider a perfect headset. No play, nice and tight. Now, all I would have to do is grab my bars, slot them in, tighten it, I'm good to go, nice and dialed, free spin headset. That's how you do piece together an SES compression. Keep in mind, you may need a headset spacer, I showed you why. Make sure there's a gap from that lip in your SES to the fork, so you do have enough room to compress it down. So let's move on to the next compression. For HIC, you're gonna wanna use the same fork, same type of fork. Any fork that is compatible with SCS is gonna be compatible with HIC. Just keep in mind, some forks are longer than others, so some forks may not be compatible with HIC depending on how big your deck is and how short your head tube angle is. As you can see, I'm just gonna loosen up my SCS. I take off my SCS, headset spacer is not needed anymore. We're just left with the remaining deck and the exposed fork. HIC is the compression where all you do need is an HIC kit and a fork that's compatible. In case you're wondering what HIC stands for, it's hidden internal compression. Since the bar covers the HIC kit, it's quote unquote hidden. In my hands, I have two HIC kits. They do the exact same thing. One is pretty decent size, bigger than the other. In my right hand, I have the all new Root Industries HIC kit. In my left hand, I have the Envy HIC kit. If you're curious to what the size difference means, it really comes in to determine how long your fork is. If you have a very long fork, you're gonna need a long HIC kit. So the Envy is a decent sized one. The Lucky HIC kit is very long as well. But let me demonstrate how it is that you guys would put this on. So you would take just the shim, you can set this aside for now, and you would slide it down the fork just like you did with SCS. You see that gap from the HIC kit to the fork? That's a good size gap. But say I did have a longer fork and the fork was reaching the top of the SCS, it wouldn't be able to properly tighten. So that's when you would need a longer HIC kit. So you would slide the HIC shim right down the fork just like I did with an SCS, and your HIC kit will come with a compression cap and a compression screw. My fork comes with this big old bolt right here. I would still use this bolt. Even though I'm using it for SCS, I would still use it with HIC, and the bolt and cap that come with it, you can just set aside, put in a drawer. You might need it later down the road if you ever get a different fork, but I would just take this guy, I would set it right on top of my fork, start the threads, reaching the end out. This is when I grab my wheel, I feel the resistance, I start to back off, and there you go. Now I take some oversized bars, slide them on, I'd be good to go. That's how you run HIC compression. Keep in mind, you might need a longer HIC kit depending on if you have a longer fork. As you guys can see, when I demonstrated SCS compression, the bars sit inside the clamp. When it comes to HIC, your bars actually slide over the entire HIC kit with a clamp on your bars. I installed this big bolt into my fork. That's how the threading is in my fork. If you do have a fork that requires a star nut, some forks don't come with star nuts, so keep in mind on the product descriptions on our site, it'll tell you if a star nut doesn't come with the fork, so you will need to purchase one and we can install it for you. And a star nut is what this bolt would screw right into. It's pretty uncommon now for forks to come with star nuts. It's kind of a thing of the past. If you do have a fork with a star nut, that's what this bolt would screw into instead of having this big bolt into your fork. Just make sure you watch out in the description of the fork to ensure that you are getting what you need. If you're running either SCS or HIC with any of the Tilt products, whether it's an SCS or a fork, there's a pretty dramatic difference. This is the top of a Tilt fork. You can see the hole with the threads where a bolt would screw in, but saying I took my Root Industries HIC kit and tried to use the bolt that came with it, it's too small. This is sliding in, that's not gonna thread. It's gonna sit loose, it's not gonna work. If you were to purchase a Tilt SCS, this comes with it. It's the same exact thing that the Root Industries HIC kit came with, but as you can see, the bolt's thicker. This is called a M8 compression bolt, and this is called an M8 compression cap. M8 is the compression size that Tilt does require. So you won't be able to use a normal size compression bolt, an M6 compression bolt, with a Tilt fork. You have to use the M8. These bolts do come with Tilt SCSs. If you do need to get one, you have a Tilt SCS, they go hand in hand. They work perfectly with each other because they're made by the same company. But if you do need just this bolt, we do sell them individually on our website. If you were running my Proto SCS with this Tilt fork, you'd have to get the M8 compression bolt and drop it in your SCS like you normally would. It sits on that lip, and then it would easily tighten down into this Tilt fork with the right size bolt. So just keep that in mind. If you do want to run Tilt SCS, it's gonna come with the M8 bolt, which is made for a Tilt fork. So you might have to purchase an M6 compression bolt and cap if you don't already have one laying around. And if you wanna run a Tilt fork with any other SCS other than a Tilt SCS, you are going to need an M8 bolt. So you're gonna have to buy one of these. That's a big thing. Keep that in mind if you're looking to buy any Tilt parts, especially SES or a fork. There are a couple other forks on the market that require M8 bolts. The Aztec Anthem fork now runs an M8 bolt and the all new Aztec Redux fork. It's becoming an industry standard because running the bigger bolt with the 6mm head is decreasing the risk of rounding out your bolts by a lot, and it's really improving strength. So keep in mind, if you're gonna be getting either the new Aztec Anthem fork or the new version of the Anthem fork, the Redux fork, or tilt forks, you're gonna have to run an M8 bolt. So that's pretty much it with HIC, SCS. Let's move on to the fan favorite, IHC compression. So like I said before, this is everything you are gonna need to run IHC compression. Two headset bearings, dust cover that comes with your headset, the IHC compression cap, the IHC compression bolt, IHC compression shim, and this is very important. This is an IHC compression ring. This is thinner, as you can see. It's a thinner one. It's made to fit the thinner IHC fork. So if I were to slide this on, it fits perfectly. This is a compression ring that goes on a normal size fork, like the fork that runs HIC or SCS. And as you can see, there's a dramatic difference. This one is way too wide. This one fits perfectly. If you guys do buy a new headset, you're gonna get another one of these. Throw this one in a drawer. You have to keep the same one that came with your IHC fork because it's required. So keep that in mind. You buy IHC, you're running it, you decide to get a new headset, you're gonna get a new one of these. Don't use it. Hang on to this one because you need it. This is everything I'm gonna need. I'm gonna go ahead and put it together for you guys and demonstrate it. I'm gonna take my fork and my bearing, the grooves pointed up, slide it right on through the deck. Bam, I'm gonna pull this out real quick. And as you can see on this fork, this has an integrated crown raise. 90% of the new forks have integrated crown raises. When I slide this bearing down, it fits perfectly and it can spin freely. Keep in mind, your fork may not have one, and whenever you do buy a new headset, it comes with crown raise. But if you slide a crown raise down on a fork and it doesn't work, it means you have an integrated one. But all IHC forks have integrated crown raises, so just keep that in mind. So I'm gonna slide this on through. I'm gonna grab my other bearing with the grooves pointed down to match the deck. Take my compression ring, my IHC compression ring, not any compression ring, my one that's made for IHC with the slit in it. Slide that down just like that. That stops the wiggle. You take your shim, and as you can see, this is a used HIC kit. This is a used scooter, so if it works for me, it's gonna work for you. And I'm taking my IHC kit. It starts to groove up, tapering in. That means it's the top. I slide that on down. You take this big long bolt with your cap and you screw this on and you start to just screw it in. And as you can see, I haven't put my dust cover on because that is the last thing that you do when it comes to IHC. Tighten this guy down. So I'm starting to feel resistance. Feels good to me. And as you can see, it's not spinning as freely as it normally because I don't have a wheel on it to add the weight, but I can feel it and perfectly fine. Now you get your dust cover. Like I said, it was the last thing you do, and you just slide it down over the shim and then bang. That's how you piece together IHC. So now you grab your bars, make sure they are standard bars with a slit or aluminum bars with a slit. Slide them on. The one thing with IHC, since this dust cover just kind of spins freely right here, if you're a freak about having a dialed scooter, this thing will rattle around if you don't apply weight down on your bar while you tighten your clamp. So if you have a friend hanging around with you, have him put his weight down on your bar, making sure it's aligned with your wheel, and you can tighten up your clamp and that'll stop this guy from making noise. If you have a headset, you've been riding it, it's starting to make a creaking noise, pretty much means you need to grease it. Completely normal. It's a precision bearing. It needs grease to spin right. What we use here at the Vault is called TriFlow. You can pick this up at a bike shop. You basically just want to damper a little bit around the seal. It'll drip into the bearing. Slide my dust cover over, slide my bars, throw my wheel, I'm good to go. Now that we piece together the three compressions, SCS, HIC, and IHC, let's talk about the pros and the cons about them and which one is gonna be right for you. So let's talk about the pros of SCS. The main thing is SCS is the strongest compression. Not having a slit in the bar, because when you ride SCS, you don't need a slit. You have to make sure you have no slit in your bar. Not having a slit's really gonna help increase the strength of the bar. You're not gonna have to worry about it cracking at the slit, and that's what makes SCS the strongest compression out there. It's one of the simplest compressions to put together. All you do need is the fork, the SES, possibly a headset spacer, and your compression bolt. That's it. Depending on what SES you get, not any SES, depending on which one you get, you can ride oversized and standard size bars. With a baby proto SES like I ride, you can only run standard size bars. With this Tilt SES that I had earlier, it's an LT SES, which means it can only run standard bars as two. 85% of the other SESs out there can run both size bars. That means they have a shim that comes in it. So if you're running standard size bars, shim will fill the gap. And if you're running oversized bars, it fits perfectly. It can run both compressions. Good thing to have, gives you plenty of options for bars in the future and stuff like that. The last really good thing about SES is it stays the tightest the longest. You don't really have to mess with it too often. Once you crank it down a good bit, it doesn't wiggle loose as often as some of the others might. So now let's talk about the cons of SES. One of them is it is the heaviest. Having a fork and that big quad clamp, it's gonna add weight to your scooter. It's not a dramatic amount of weight, but if you're a smaller rider, you might need a lighter scooter. So one of the other compressions here might work out better for you than SES. With that weight, you're making it up with strength. Another big con about it is the most expensive compression out there due to needing a fork, which could be $60 to $100, and then an SES that could range from about $40 to $60, $70. You have to have both of them in order for it to work. Who is SES for? The bigger rider, a rider who's breaking parts, if you're snapping bars, snapping clamps, SES is what you're gonna need. If you're throwing your scooter, you're jumping big staircases, and you're worried about durability and weight's not a factor for you, go with SES. It's pretty much the best compression out there if you are breaking parts and you need more durability. That's who SES is for. If this video inspired you, pick up an SES. So let's talk about HIC. What are the pros? One of the good ones is if you prefer the look of a double clamp, you can run a double clamp. All you do need is an oversized double clamp, because with HIC compression, we're gonna get into the cons, but one of the cons is you can only run oversized bars. You can't run standard size bars with a slit. You have to run 100% oversized bars with a slit. You can run a double clamp. If you like the way double clamps look, that's where you can run it. So all you're needing an HIC kit, a bar, and a fork makes it really simple. The last couple pros about HIC is it's got very similar strength to SES. It's not as strong as SES, but it is a strong compression. The slit in the bar is gonna add a weak point in the bar. So if you're out there snapping bars, that's where you'll probably end up snapping them at. Another good thing is it's one of the least expensive compressions, because to run it, all you do need to buy externally is an HIC kit if you already do have an oversized bar and a fork. The cons of HIC are you need a slit in your bar that puts a weak point in your bar. Not too dramatic, but if you're out there snapping bars, that's why. A big con about HIC bars is they can't run aluminum bars. There's no way you'll be able to run aluminum bars with HIC compression. That is due to the outside diameter of the bar, where you actually can grab on the bar, is oversized, but the inside of the bar is standard. You cannot run HIC with aluminum bars. And the last con about HIC, like I talked about earlier, is you can only run oversized bars, oversized steel or titanium bars. You can't ride as many bars with HIC due to you only being able to ride oversized, but there's plenty of really, really good oversized bars out there for you guys to get. Who is HIC compression for? HIC compression is pretty much for the person right in the middle. You don't really care to have the lightest scooter in the world. You don't want the heaviest. You want something right in the middle. That's where HIC comes into play. It's not gonna be as light as IHC. It's not gonna be as heavy as SES, and you're not out there breaking parts. HIC is gonna be perfect for you. You can run those steel bars. You can run some titanium bars. HIC is a really comfortable compression if you're out there in the middle of not wanting a light, not wanting a heavy scooter. The pros of IHC compression are, one, the lightest of the three. You want light, IHC is gonna come into play. You can run both size bars, oversized and standard, if you do have a conversion shim. IHC is very, very easy to maintain. There's not too many pieces to it. Very easy to tighten the compression. All you have to do is pull your bars off and tighten that bolt on top. You can easily get access to your headset like I showed you earlier. So when it comes to maintenance, it comes in really handy. Another good thing is you can run aluminum bars with IHC. You can't run aluminum bars with HIC. You can with SES. If you have an SES that fits oversized bars, aluminum bars pretty much work perfectly with IHC. All you have to do is put a slit in those aluminum bars and they fit perfectly over an IHC fork. One of the last few things is it's very, very affordable. Unlike the other ones where you have to buy external parts to run it, when you buy an IHC fork, it comes with an IHC kit with it. If you have an oversized bar with a conversion kit, you're good. That's all you need. The fork pretty much comes with everything. If you're balling on a budget, IHC might be the better solution for you. To wrap it up, let's talk about the cons of IHC. One of the biggest things is it is the weakest compression out of the others. Being Aichi, you have that thinner fork with the shim, you are going to have a weaker compression. Having a slit in your bar too makes it a little bit weaker, but if you're a smaller rider and you're not really throwing too hard of tricks as a bigger rider, you'll be fine with Aichi. But if you're out there jumping 12 stairs and throwing your scooter, you might result in breaking your fork or something like that. That was the three main types of compression: SCS, HIC, Aichi. A little bit of a demonstration on how to piece it together, and hopefully you guys did learn something about them in case you didn't know. Do let us know if you guys wanna see us do another video on the other types of compressions that are out there. We read the comments. If you guys liked me, make sure you follow me on Instagram. It'll be down below. Make sure you guys are following The Vault on all our social medias: Snapchat, Facebook, Instagram, MySpace. I don't know, we're out there. Make sure you follow us, and until next time, have a good one.